Over to my colleague, Rosalba, who will offer some reflections on the breach of medicine and the work of Italian studies at the University of Liverpool.
Now I have someone speaking. Is everyone on mute? That's great. Wonderful. Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much. Right. So the first of our speakers this evening, as you've seen from the invitation, that we have four people who are all working in higher education and all using TikTok to reach their key audiences. So I'd love to introduce you to our first speaker this evening, who is Matt Horne. And Matt Horne is the Senior Marketing Manager at Newcastle University in the UK. And Matt has at least 10 years experience in digital marketing. So Matt, if I can hand over to you, if you're ready to present, that would be great.
Yeah, sure. Hello, I'm Matt, talking to you from Newcastle, northeast of England. I feel like it's a bit like Eurovision. So I'm just going to share my screen, kick straight in because I know time is limited. At Newcastle, we're using TikTok as a paid channel at the moment. We rarely use it for organic, and we've been using it since July 2020, and we started using it as part of our clearing campaign. So for those in the UK working in HE, you'll know clearing is a massive recruitment drive over the summer period up to results day, where the idea is to get yourself in front of as many eyeballs as possible and drive leads as well as, at the end of the day, applications. So we ran it during there, we had some great results, so we've moved that into our recruitment cycle for undergraduate now, and we're using this as a undergraduate paid channel. We've been testing lots of different types of creative to understand what works, and so we started with using portrait video, but very professionally made. It was basically, we would take stuff that we run for our Instagram stories or our Snapchat ads and put them on TikTok because it's a similar kind of placement. And we got some pretty decent results. We got over 500,000 impressions. We had over 5,500 clicks, which was nearly a 1% click-through rate and a pretty cheap cost per click. Then what we found on Snapchat and Instagram stories is putting a student just talking down the lens works really well. So we've tried that style on TikTok and we saw an improvement in results. We got a higher click-through rate, we got a cheaper cost per click, and we got more impressions. Then we tried a different student, and again, we started seeing better results. We saw that there was a higher click-through rate, not as many impressions this time, but the cost per click was fairly consistent. And then you keep hearing about that, make sure your creative's TikTok, do a TikTok, make a TikTok video, be all TikTok-y. So we decided to go find some students and we said, make us an advert, please, that's TikTok-y, because I'm 38 and I'm not TikTok-y. I've been on it for a bit. It's a bit of an attention sinkhole and I got rid of it, but I understand that the people we're trying to target it use it quite a lot. And we had one student and he came back with a TikTok video where it's not the kind of thing we would use for our normal branding, but it works because that, as you might believe it, is advertising the UCAS deadline day in a blog that people could read. And we ended up with the highest click-through rate we've seen for TikTok yet. And again, a really cheap cost per click. So we're still practicing, but in terms of what TikTok's driving for us as a lead generation, a lot of people say you can't use TikTok for lead gen. They told us that about Snapchat. They've told us that about Google Discover. They've told us that about some YouTube campaigns. But with our paid activity, we consistently see what people consider as a display and an awareness channel work for leads when we're using them. So we tested that theory with TikTok. And as you can see from these results, we got the most impressions through TikTok. We got the cheapest, almost the cheapest cost per acquisition. And we got some of the highest click-throughs compared to other channels. So it really is, it's worked for us for lead gen and it's worked for us for getting impressions at the same time. In terms of the successes we've had with TikTok, TikTok did a case study on us because they were so impressed with the kind of stuff we were doing and the results we were getting. We then ended up with blog posts being written about the stuff that we're doing, which is fantastic for my ego and looks great for my director of marketing because he thinks that I'm doing a good job, which I am, but I mean, it's nice to have the external proof. But what matters more, as well as getting top ad created in TikTok's library of adverts, is the fact that we're driving leads into our CRM, which means we can then market to them and push them further to the application. So over essentially a couple of campaigns in October and November, we didn't do much in December, we got 537 leads into our CRM with a very low spend. So that was a pretty impressive result for us. There are challenges when it comes to TikTok as a paid channel. The main one is it has definitely got its teething problems. It is brand new. The self-serve platform only went live last summer, so they're still working it. It is nowhere near, for those that are used to running their own campaigns, it's nowhere near Facebook's level of user-friendliness and adaptability and trackability. The targeting is still needing a lot of work there. For those that have worked in digital marketing for a while, think Twitter back in the early 2010s, in the kind of targeting you could do with Twitter advertising there. It's not the best. The quality of traffic, we found it will be like a nuclear explosion of traffic onto your website, but the conversion rate can be quite low. So it's quite a wide scattergun approach, similar to Snapchat though. There is, like I said, limited tracking. They have a pixel. It can track certain things, but it is very much in the Snapchat pixel area of tracking, as opposed to Facebook's current pixel, where you can get quite granular tracking. Granted, that will be changing essentially this week with the iOS 14 updates. And the main challenge is developing that TikTok creative. So like I've said, we've seen our traditional stories-focused content does still work quite well. But when we get that more kind of tongue-in-cheek, raw look, TikTok style, it does tend to do quite well. And finding people to make that content is difficult. We don't tend to have a lot of influencers on our campus that are happy to do adverts for us. We do pay all our students that make advertising for us, but even then, there's still not the drive to get the quality or the level of TikTok-y content we would be happy to put money behind. That said, we've just done results for last month for a campaign, and the type of creative that won on TikTok was a simple colored background with text overlay. No students involved, no fancy video editing, just really simple text overlay on a colored background. So go figure, it changes every month. So that was a really quick whistle stop tour. Any questions?
Thanks. Yeah, sorry, Susan, I was going to say thanks very much, Matt. We haven't yet got any questions in the feed. So, here we go. They're coming through very quickly. So go straight in with Emma Jameson, who's asking what the bounce rates are. What's the bounce rate on the click-throughs?
It does depend on the call to action and the landing page, but it is high. We've seen bounce rates of 99% for one campaign. We've seen bounce rates around 60% for other campaigns. It's consistently over 50% though. And that's where it comes with. It is very much a tidal wave of traffic and some will convert, but in the long run, they're cheaper to get there and you get higher volume than some other channels.
Right. Great. And JB9215 asks what kind of results you're seeing through your organic content.
Well, like I said, we don't do organic, so we purely run paid on TikTok.
Okay.
And talk us through a little bit more the reasons for that. And
because as a university, we've not found what our voice would be for TikTok. We don't want to just replicate content we're putting on other channels, and we tend to find our organic social media is very much a current student communications channel. It has a side effect of being good for student recruitment, because people will find you and they'll see what's happening on your campus and that kind of secondary engagement. But for actually, if you want results for recruitment, paid is the channel we find we get the most results from. If we were to do organic on TikTok, it would be current student focused, but we just don't have that kind of student face that we haven't found the right person or the right people to put onto TikTok.
Great. Lots and lots of questions coming through. Shall I, Susie, ask one more and then...
Yeah, Lauren Burgess. Lauren's asked, how much resources do you invest into following viral TikTok trends, duets, filters, sounds, etc.?
I've got a small team. There's a team of three, now four, because somebody's back from maternity cover. And as part of our work across all paid channels, we keep on top of trends for our undergraduate, postgraduate, research, promotion, corporate comms, all the different things we do through paid. We do keep an eye on the different trends and keep up on research. For TikTok, it would be an hour or so a month where we keep it. We have newsletters that we subscribe to. We have an account manager at TikTok who helps feed us with useful information. And also, because we keep featuring in the top creative on TikTok's ad library, just those notifications, we see the, what other people are running in our industry. There's not a lot that gets featured in there at the moment, but we can kind of see what's working in the advertising space, which again is different to organic. There's no doubt about it. You can use organic style on TikTok, but there is a paid TikTok style and an organic TikTok style.
Right. Interesting. Would it work for over 25-year-olds, Anne says?
If they're on TikTok. Apparently, according to all their slide decks and presentations, they're not just about young people. They do have an older generation. So give it a go. Find out. You can target up to 50-year-olds through their paid platform. So run some campaigns and see if you get results.
Yeah, interesting. And someone's asking as well if how you balance concerns about your paid content driving the students to create their own possibly negative content about the university.
Well, that's the same across any channel. There's always going to be negative content created organically, and you can't control that. That's the joy of the internet. You can try and influence and engage with those that create negative content using social listening. But at the end of the day, unless they're saying something that they're not allowed to legally or contractually, there's not a lot you can do about that. And if they're actually saying something truthful about your organization, then maybe you need to address that.
Yeah. Thank you, Matt. No, that's a really good point. That's been around forever, really, hasn't it? Brilliant. Thanks. Great questions, guys. Should we? We'll obviously have some time at the end, hopefully, just to run through any last minute questions. But I'd like to move on to our next speaker, if that's okay. So Sheena, can I introduce you? So Sheena leads the external communications function for the University of Limerick in Ireland. And I, as I said earlier, I'm not going to try to pronounce it in its Irish name. But you can do it for us, Sheena.
Old school Limney, but it's known as University of Limerick. We'd use the English and UL in particular. So, hi, everybody. That's really fascinating because let me just share the screen here. We're the opposite, in actual fact, from what Matt is doing. We are only doing organic content. So interesting to see, very interesting to hear from Matt's perspective there for me. So we would have been a very early adopter of TikTok. We joined in May 2019, so we're about 2 years on there. This is a quick overview for our results, I suppose, in the past year. I think because we were an early adopter, we ended up, we now have the biggest account in the public sector in Ireland. And I think it's just been the past year where you're finding other institutions and other public bodies are beginning to come on board. We would have actually probably expected for a much bigger set of results for 2020, but none of us could have anticipated the year that we were facing into. So in one sense, we were happy with what we got there. So this is us. There's the account. We call ourselves the CEO of the CAO. The CAO is the Central Applications Office, which is the medium through which everyone in Ireland applies to the higher education system. So what did we do? Really, at the beginning, I suppose TikTok began as a dance platform. And so we started with looking at some of the trends that were going very viral on TikTok. And then we began to see, okay, well, how could UL exploit the power of this new platform? It was a very young audience base that was engaging with it. And we jumped on board of some of the dance trends very early on. One of them there, you can see, we would have had 2 million views on one. It was called the Hand Clap Challenge. It was early on in August 2019. It was a dance that everybody began to do. So we, on our graduation day, just got two of our graduates to learn it in the morning, shared it by later on that day. And it went very far. It's a little bit quiet of late. We have one social media officer at UL to cover all of our institutional accounts from LinkedIn to TikTok. So it's tricky to, in the past year, have had the focus to be able to foster this channel in the middle of the COVID crisis and communications elsewhere. And we're actually in the middle of social media officers at the moment. So it's quite quiet at the moment. So what do we use it for? We use it really not actually as a sales funnel. So there aren't call to actions on our TikTok account. What we use it for is a window to illustrate what the student experience at UL will be like. we probably have prospective students in the back of our mind in terms of the main audience that we're looking to speak to. Although we know from engagement that our own current students are also very interested. So we look at what might trend or what might be trending, be it dance or music or a particular way of taking a video. And then we look to match it to a unique selling point of UL's. And mostly that is in and around profiling our campus, which is one of our big selling points, and our student experience through like clubs and societies type videos and that kind of content. So this will just give you a little idea. Just there on the right-hand side, you have an idea of the engagement. So this post had about 23,500 views, and I'll just play it here so you can have an idea.
If you wanna say I won't go back, if you wanna hit the road, then let's go then. Let's just go and see the world and just show them what it really means to live life golden. Yeah, we're golden, baby, girl, we're golden.
And here's another.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Level up, 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 level up. All this on me so yummy. All this sounds so yummy. No, you want this yummy.
So the wolf pack is how our students refer to themselves. Wolfie is our university mascot. So that's what we're mainly using it for, a window into the student experience. If it's profiling our university, if you're already a warm prospect, for example, you'll come on here and this will reinforce your interest in attending the University of Limerick, hopefully. So one of the other things that we do is we engage in the comments section, and that drives huge engagement, and it moves whatever content we have onto the kind of For You page, which is what you're aiming for when you're having TikTok. So you can see here, what course should I attend our open days? It allows us to sort of, you know, give it a bit of soft messaging. And just over here, I was saying it to Morgan earlier, we can have some in university banter actually goes on. That was a post we put up about it was actually an Instagram message, that a voice message that came in through DMs on our Instagram going, how do I go to college? You know, and so the other universities are kind of like, oh, I can relate. But it's a good place for that kind of more casual, playful tone of voice. That's what we would find at UL. So how do we do it? We do it only through organic content. We haven't gotten into the area of putting paid content on there yet. And we do it with student social media officers. So as I said, one social media officer, but we set up a system where we have UL students that we will pay and commission to produce content for them. We start them at the beginning of the year. They'll produce content for quite a few of our channels, I suppose really Instagram and our TikTok. And we have them on a sort of a WhatsApp group. We encourage them all the time. Has anybody seen anything out there that looks kind of fun, that might be fun to do? They'll send back, you know, messages of, what if we do this? What if we do that? They'll produce it all themselves, and but it's curated. So we will see, obviously, what it is that they're suggesting before we put it out and maybe tweak it one way or the other. But we really encourage them for their ideas. Matt said that he was 38. I'm 14. So I definitely am not necessarily very closely tuned in with what it is that's going to go on viral. I am on TikTok myself. I do enjoy it. It definitely is a bit of a black hole, all right. But they are more close, our students are, to what it is that's actually going to register well. I mean, we want to use this platform to provide our followers with what they're on TikTok looking for. So that's lighthearted, general kind of content. So this was one that one of our student social media officers suggested. It was at the beginning of 2020 as the campus was getting ready for our semester two in the year. But again, you can see in the side, I just copied there the kind of comments and engagement that actually come from this one. So this was, it's captioned me in my mom's car, broom, broom.
Bang it, if you know the police trying to get you riding dirty, trying to get me 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 riding dirty, we got the whole sound.
So the last, just have one more slide. The last thing I'd say is one of the last year then has been very strange. So how do we pivot from profiling our clubs and societies and our campus living and life? What are we going to put on there now? And how do we do it while we're focused on emergency student comms in the middle of this crisis? So, you know, we had some messaging when we did have a certain amount of our student body back on campus, all about, you know, mask wearing, hand washing, all that kind of stuff. So we were trying to find a creative way to put that across on TikTok. And then also we have found that are the same, and all higher ed colleagues, I'm sure, would attest to the same thing. Campus imagery and video is still very, very popular, and it's still very, very popular on this channel in the same way that it can be on many of the others. So oftentimes we'll just come up with, maybe if we have a piece of drone footage and there's a trending music track, we'll put it behind it with a message for something, and they always go down really well. So this statue is really iconic. It's in the middle of our university, and it's actually, handily, it's entitled Together and Apart. So we used it quite a bit in our messaging about what we needed our campus community of staff and students to be doing for the past year. But this is just a trend. The eyes and the mouth is a trend on the organic content in TikTok as well.
You have to stop.
I'm sorry.
Trying to put a mask on me. I'm a statue. I can't get coronavirus. And I have no ears. Just put a mask on yourself. Please.
So that's it, really. My main point, and this is one I think that Anu will probably make as well. You have to just try things. You mightn't always get it right. There's been a few pieces of video content we've put up there that we thought, oh, this is going to go really far, and it just hasn't, you know. But I think we're staying away from it trying to appear to be too marketing driven. It's a bit of fun. It's a window to our student experience, and that's the way we've gone with it. So brilliant. I'm going to just stop sharing this.
Thank you, Sheena. Sorry, I bet Anthony Gormley never thought one of his statues would do that. Brilliant.
Don't tell him.
No. Crispin, any?
Yeah, so let me run through some of the things coming. So before we get to questions, Emily Oakden says, fangirling Sheena, love the Uni of Limerick TikTok. And you had another nice comment in there, which I will find and throw to you as we work through the various questions. I wanted to start with one of my own, if that's okay. It's, how important is it to be an early adopter? I mean, if you're not in there now, have you missed the boat?
I don't think so. I think we were very lucky. Our social media officer, who has actually left us since, was just super keen on all things new in the social media world. So I remember the day he came in to me, Tony was his name, he was like, oh, there's this new video thing. And we actually started, really, the first videos we have on there, we had one best campus in Ireland, and we said, okay, well, how are we going to profile this? We have an Academy of Music and Dance, and we got dancers from our own academy to dance at different spots around the campus. That kind of went okay, but it gave us a feel for how to engage with this new platform. And I think we were somewhat lucky at the beginning going viral early. Like an awful lot was expressed of surprise about the fact that, oh, UL has a TikTok, you know, because I think that's the beauty of getting in early as a brand. It was probably a channel that was driven by individuals. So there wasn't an expectation to see a brand in there. And then having a very lighthearted, somewhat casual tone of voice. So I think for most of the consumers of our content on there, they just think it's a lot of fun, but each piece that we put out is connected somehow or other to some sort of USP. It's tends to be subtle, but it's in there. We haven't ever had any of our student social media officers go rogue. I think the fact that we kind of pay them means they're invested, and they also love the TikTok channel themselves, and they love the chance to play with it and, you know, do something new and exciting. So we, nothing has gone very badly wrong yet.
Great. And on that, Jamie Lee Baker said, University of Limerick seem to have really engaged and social savvy students. Definitely agree with using organic to show the student experience. Another question from Kenny McDonald from Project Trust on the Isle of Col. Lucky Kenny being on the Isle of Col. Sheena, a natural question. Are you finding profile raising organic content is translating into good return to meet your goals or provide conversions?
It's difficult to track that through this particular channel. One of the things that it does allow you to do that we've done quite successfully is when you have your TikTok video produced and shared, you can repurpose it. We will use it on our Instagram stories, you know, and that drives people potentially then from one to the other. We found last year is so difficult to judge anything by, but the year previous when we had first introduced ourselves on TikTok, we found at our open day an awful lot of our attending second level students mentioning the TikTok account, you know, looking to be tagged, wanting to be featured. So they were certainly aware of it. And we would also find again, you know, during our conferring ceremonies, things like that, you'll see a rise in UL type content because our students know that we're on there. But it's very difficult. We don't have a sophisticated method of figuring out where in the sales funnel TikTok is sitting. The idea is just that it reinforces the rest of the things we're trying to do. UL is a home of firsts is our general campaign tagline. So we make sure we put in firsts in there. But it's hard, it's not one where it's an easy return on investment formula.
Great, thank you. And if we try to squeeze just one more question, a couple of people, Leanne and Kirsty have asked similar questions, really just asking about how you're dealing with the kind of limited music options in TikTok when you're using a business account.
Our students really figure that out for me, to be honest. And I actually think a lot of the time the music, the music we use is already trending. Because I suppose the limit of the music can be often limited, you're hearing it over and over again in a lot of the TikToks, and then it turns into a bit of a trend. So yeah, if that answers the question.
Okay, thank you, Sheena.
No problem. Cool.
Lovely, that's great. Such an interesting contrast between your two ways of using it. So I'd now like to introduce our next speaker, who is Morgan. And Morgan is the social media and digital marketing specialist for Indiana University, Bloomington in America. And Morgan told us earlier when we were just chatting that they've got 9 campuses, which kind of blew our mind of the size and the student base. So thank you, Morgan. Go ahead and tell us all about it.
Yeah, thanks. So let me get this up. So we have 9 campuses, but the one that I'm at is IU Bloomington specifically, and we're the flagship, so the main big campus in our state. I've been running this TikTok for, when did we get it? December 2018. Sorry, I'm trying to hit next here. And that was really right about the time that Musical.ly turned into TikTok. And honestly, we have like a very similar story with University of Limerick because we got a lot of our inspiration from them. So for the first few months, it was my third month, and I asked my colleague there, I'm like, you know, this is kind of blowing up. Can we at least go save our name on there? And he's like, yeah, let's go for it. And if we can think of some ideas, let's try that. And at the time, transitions were very big, and that it's still big today, I think. And so we're like, let's see how we can do that. So this was our very first TikTok.
Hey,
very similar to Limerick. We're like, let's highlight our environmental beauty of campus. That's really why a lot of people love to come here. And for us, we get called Hogwarts a lot, which for Indiana is pretty big. There's not a lot here except cornfield. So we're like, let's highlight this pretty campus. And so that was really our first two goals, was to do that. And then also really focus on students. So when I say we did a lot of research, it was me sitting on TikTok for hours on end, which is entertaining. And also you can get down a very deep hole. So after, now it's been 2 years, over 2 years now, which is crazy. We kind of expanded what our strategy and our tactics would be, and really using our students to reach students. Our primary goal is to show that student life, and there's no reason why we can't use our students. They're the ones on there. They know the trends. They know the personality of TikTok. And so we have, we actually have 4 interns, 2 who focus on video and 2 who focus on just content. And this girl right here, Caroline, who's on our screen, has really taken off this year with finding those trends and really making it IU, feel like IU. So we use that to connect with our students. A lot of our boring or like our more serious content, when I say that, like, you know, wear a mask and the things we've heard over and over again, or go get your vaccine, because right now, in the entire country, everyone can get their vaccine. So we've really been pushing that messaging. And so one of the things we did, which I won't play the whole thing, was just showing reasons why you should get your vaccine. So a really fun way to show like why you should get it, where it's not just like another adult talking at them why they need to take care of themselves. So we've really been thriving on that lately. And then also just showing our IU pride. So in everything, we make sure our students are dressed with IU gear as much as possible. And there's a lot of traditions here. So showing our statues and also staying consistent as possible, which can be very difficult, especially when you're not on campus. We're still work from home, but our students are on campus. So it's been kind of a challenge, but that's why we use our students. So we're featuring our students. Our main target is future and current students. Obviously TikTok has expanded this past year, but they're still the largest audience is that like 16 to 22 year old. And we've noticed a lot of our students lately have been tagging us and mentioning us in their videos. So we know they're on there. So it's just a matter of just trying to reach them and engage with them. So one of the examples, and I won't play this one, but we just had one of our other interns, Gabby, just take us through a life of the day. So 1 minute vlog style videos have been pretty popular, and I've seen them work for other universities. So she just took clips of her entire day, used the voiceover feature, and then just showed everyone her experience. And it was just a nice different piece of content that like can show our future students like what our campus is about. And these are just a few comments I wanted to point out, because when we were talking to our leadership, trying to encourage them why we should have TikTok, it's because of comments like these. So, you know, I want to join the Marching 100 in 2 years, like see you in 2 years, or can't wait for next year. I know we've had people say like class of 2030 or something, and I'm like, wow, you're so young, and I feel so old. But it's so great that you're already having this digital touch point with us, because this could be their first time ever interacting with our university at 14, 15 years old. I mean, that's huge, because then we're on our radar for the next, you know, 4 to 5 years. So that's why we always try and comment, especially to the comments that are like in the first day, like reply to those and like those, because it really gets them excited that, you know, a big university is responding to them, when in reality, it's just me on my couch, you know, eating popcorn. So super fun. And then especially this past year, we've been really using it as a listening tool. So searching your university's name with hashtags, or if they've mentioned you, if you do have a profile, in watching those, we've been able to keep an eye on, like, you know, if students in their isolation dorm, we had one student like show off the dorm, and it obviously isn't the prettiest place because it's isolated, and that blew up on TikTok. And so there are things like that where we can watch on there, but also there's some good things. So Michael Winner, he on the screen here, he's actually like gaining a lot of following on his TikTok just from his funny videos, like over 250,000 followers. And so now he's kind of like one of our micro influencers, and we were able to connect with him, and he did a video with us where he went on the street and throughout campus and asked students questions like, you know, how big is IU's campus, and just silly things like that. And that was one of our best videos this past year with views, because everyone already knew him because he was like a mini TikTok star, but also like the collaboration just kind of blew people's minds. And he has been great with content going forward. So that's, we haven't really had a great experience finding influencers like on Twitter or Instagram, but on TikTok, I mean, they're right there. They're tagging you or they're mentioning you sometimes. So it's been really great to have that. And then, so for our first video, when we actually went viral, it was actually a very random thing, which I think a lot of brands and just really anyone on TikTok, their first viral video, you did not expect it to go viral. And so we got over 100,000 likes, which is like the most we had. And it was just videos that I went and teamed up with our volleyball team, recorded four different videos within an hour, and just did some of the trends that were happening at the time. And finally, like, it took 8 months of us having the actual account where we were gaining a lot of followers. And it was like a really easy thing. So I always like tell my interns, don't think too hard about the content. Just as long as it's trending and it's fun. I mean, that's really the secret formula, which isn't much of a formula. And I know everyone hates to hear that. But yeah, it's been interesting to see which ones work. And like Sheena said, like the ones you really put a lot of time into, you want to go viral, they don't. And the ones you don't, end up like this. So just some numbers, in the last 2 years, we gained over 24,000 followers, which is great, nearly 400,000 likes. And that really helped when we got verified. Actually, TikTok reached out to us on our Instagram account, and that's how we built that relationship. And it's been really great going forward because we've had some videos pinned to the Explore page because we have that relationship, and they'll let us know what trends or campaigns they have going on that week. And if we have one that's like related to that or could fit that description, then they'll feature a video for us, which is really great. So really the main takeaways from this, I tell people, you know, research and really experiment. Like if you post something that doesn't do great, just go on and do the next one. Because you, like I said, there's no great formula to it. And eventually you'll start to feel that personality that you want to really capture with your account. And then knowing your audience. So if you want to target prospective students, you know, look for those fun trends that are kind of cringy to us probably, but they'll work for our younger students. If they're too cringy though, be careful, because then people might make fun of you. We've had that too. And then also just finding those trends, we just really explore our For You page, find a sound that isn't limited to us, to our business account, and we'll save it. And we may not do it that week, but we'll do it like the next week or in a month even. And we'll have that library saved, which is great when we're like, okay, what should we do next if we're kind of slow on ideas? Also be patient. Because it's not gonna happen overnight. It definitely takes some like time being consistent, and then also just having fun. It's definitely my most favorite channel right now for us to engage with students with, because it's so casual, but also so entertaining. And you can really learn a lot from your comment section if you pay attention to it. So that was a very quick overview, but thank you.
Great. Thank you, Morgan. That's brilliant. Crispin?
Yeah, we've got some nice questions that come through for you, Morgan. I think the first one you may have answered this just after it was posted, but it's a nice comment anyway. So I'll run through it. Jamie Lee Baker saying, when you say you're seeing a lot of students are on TikTok, are they tagging you in their videos or are you using the hashtags to find them? For ARU, we're finding the hashtag with our university name is full of people who've applied through UCAS, so that's the application process in the UK, the clearing process in the UK, and are awaiting results rather than current students, which surprised us. And so if you could address that, and then perhaps we'll link that up with a more general question from Sean, is there a recommendation on how frequently to post content?
Yeah, we've been into the first half, like we've been using our hashtags. We don't use as many anymore when we post videos, but we definitely still look at what's being posted with that hashtag. And also with the For You page, it's weird in a way where like it'll depend on your location. So if I am near campus or like my student interns who live near campus, like things about IU will pop up just because they're in that same location, which is great if you're near campus. But yeah, it's really just been hashtags and then making sure we check our mentions as at least once a day to see like what's been coming in and then also what hashtags they might be using about us. Cause also the hashtag IU is a very famous K-pop star. So it gets very confusing. So we really have to like vet through some of those and figure out what else our students using to find us. And then what was the second half question?
So there's a recommendation on how frequently to post content was the other, yeah.
Yeah, so at first we were trying to post like 2 to 3 times a week, and then we just came to the conclusion that we were just trying to post, which can be great, but then our ideas were really winding down. So now I try definitely once a week, but twice a week is the goal, as long as we're not like crazy busy with something going on. And so far we've been able to do that for the most part, especially since the new school year with everyone back finally. So that's what I recommend at least.
Great, thank you.
Thank you so much, that's great. Mm-hmm. Okay, and our last speaker this evening, Anu, who is the head of social media and AV at the University of Cambridge in the UK, but is speaking to us from Lapland, which I'm quite impressed with. So thank you. Over to Anu, and there's your slides. Cool.
Thank you very much. And lovely to virtually meet you all. I will be sharing some insights and what we've learned at Cambridge from our, well, just under a year on TikTok. So I reckon we've been there the shortest out of this group. If you do want to connect with me beyond this event, you can find me on LinkedIn if you're able to spell my name. That's probably the hardest bit to get past, but do find me on Twitter and LinkedIn. We can continue the conversation. So a first slide, please, Crispin. So why did Cambridge go on TikTok? Now, this is a question we get asked even on our TikTok videos. Why is Cambridge on TikTok? Well, for us, it's really a no-brainer because we've noticed that as our social media channels are aging, also our audiences on those channels are aging, and we were no longer reaching the age group of the prospective students. So it was very natural for us to start looking for new channels. TikTok was the fastest growing social media channel last year. So we decided to join it in the middle of, you know, the pandemic, lockdown, working remotely, all of the challenges. We still felt that it was really important to get on the platform. We are noticing that we definitely are reaching those prospective students. We can see it from the comments we get on our TikToks. So similarly to Limerick, we're getting some questions around admissions and those sorts of things. But you know, we really do get comments from across the spectrum. it was also important for us to early on own the handle, and I heard this mentioned before by others as well, so that, you know, this is the real Cambridge account, this is the real Cambridge content. And with the help of TikTok, we were able to claim our handle and get it also, get the blue tick on it, so that, you know, this is the real Cambridge account, and we feel that's really important for our brand. We launched as part of an initiative called a hashtag Learn on TikTok, which was launched by TikTok last summer, but it wasn't really a paid partnership or anything like that. It was just a good reason for us to sort of, you know, use it as a hook when we had decided to go on TikTok anyway. So next, I wanted to share some of our more popular TikToks. So Crispin, if you could kindly play the video.
My name is Matt Davey, and I'm a scientist at the University of Cambridge. I'm studying snow algae in Antarctica. These are microscopic algae that bloom on the snow surface.
Most Greek women in sculptures are fully dressed. Like, there's a Diana over there, and she's fully dressed. And it's actually the men that are in the nude, so this Aphrodite is really cool and exciting because she plays with those norms, like.
I remember reading a list of questions that you might be asked at your interview, and one of them was, if you were a kitchen utensil, which one would you be? And
so this is unpolarized light, with every photon polarized in a different direction. Alternative to that, of course, is polarized light, where the electric field only vibrates in one particular direction, like classic 1970s John Travolta.
When I was at school, which was a fair time ago, I always was the sort who kept my tie down up right to the top. Even in the summer, when we were told you didn't have to wear ties, I wanted to keep mine on. So.
Thank you, Crispin. So this was really to give you just a quick flavor of the type of content we've been posting on TikToks. So we're trying to show the research that goes on at the university, obviously to inspire the next generation, and also as part of that learning and educational content. But we also feel it's important to show the people of Cambridge, show our students, show our lecturers. And we are facing this challenge of how do we find the content? How do we source the content? And we are trying to use very creative ways to do that. So one of the ways we've been doing is repurposing content, which is not recommended by TikTok at all, because ideally you would be, you know, pointing your mobile phone at the topic and then creating something very TikTok specific. But we felt that, you know, it's the early stages, let's experiment and let's see what we can do. It felt more important to get on the platform and start learning as we are on it, rather than trying to perfect our approach. It's also important to be able to show people, like, you know, this is actually working. We are actually reaching prospective students. Would you be interested in starting to create content? And next slide, please. So I will talk a bit about the approach we've taken at Cambridge. So as I said, we've started it really as an experiment. You know, we've tried to be very allowing with ourselves, and also be aware of the fact that we are all middle-aged. You know, we're not 16-year-olds, and we shouldn't try too hard. We don't want to look cringe. It still has to feel like Cambridge. That said, you know, we do have a brand refresh undergoing, so I think this is also a good opportunity for us to be a bit more experimental, because we don't have a massive following yet. I would also like to say that we see it as a journey. So our Instagram is just about to reach 1 million followers, and I think we'll be the first in Europe to do that. So And when we started Instagram, really in the first 5 to 6 months, any Instagram post would get somewhere around 150 to 300 likes. So I like to think about that and remind ourselves that, you know, it's okay to take it slow and it's okay to experiment and find our feet and also find the people who could be the face of Cambridge and who could create that TikTok specific TikTok tailored content. So we are very much on the search for in-house talent. So we are trying this equally with students, lecturers, anybody we think would be good on TikTok. Sometimes we're using Instagram really to spot talent. So for example, Professor Harrison, who was doing, you know, the John Travolta, we spotted him from an Instagram story from one of his students. So we are using very creative ways to find content. Next slide. I'd like to talk a bit about the analytics. So everything that we do on TikTok is organic. Cambridge doesn't traditionally do paid marketing. So we are very much relying on our luck and on the For You page. But just to give you an idea of why we've also been very pleased with being on TikTok. So I already mentioned that we want to reach the younger audiences. And what we are seeing is that over 60% of our followers are actually female. So we are reaching that younger female audience. And we are very keen to encourage them to consider STEM and consider sciences. So it's very refreshing and actually welcome to us, because on some of our older social media channels such as YouTube and Twitter, we've got a predominantly male audience. And our top territory is UK, so we've got a very UK based following. The other thing I wanted to mention in terms of best times to post, we're finding that our followers are active between 5 and 7 p.m. you know, UK time, or I guess it's universal time that TikTok uses. So we do try to use those timings. And TikTok recently launched a desktop app. So it's actually possible to schedule TikToks through that app. So we try to do this as part of our team content planning, which we do on a daily basis. So we've got a shared responsibility for creating TikTok content. And each of us are trying to find that talent. So I apologize for the very, very tiny size of the other screen, but I just wanted to highlight to you that one of our more popular videos, which was the rebel wearing a bow tie. What we're seeing is when we start getting those higher views, most of those views do come from the For You page, which is the homepage as you open your TikTok app on your phone. So anything that has got pickup, you know, it comes from that, because our following is still relatively small. Now, where the following is really important is for those videos that don't get pickup on the For You page, that don't get shared and seen by a lot of people in their feed, we rely on our following to give us that steady flow of views. Next slide, please. So I wanted to share some content ideas, because this is a question we get asked, you know, what content should I do on TikTok? Now, I would say if you can lead with people, do that. I mean, people like watching people. Leading with people is really the best thing to do. And ideally have them in the first 2 seconds, as well as on the thumbnail. Secondly, as we've seen from Indiana, you can show, you know, iconic places, or you can sort of show the student experience. Where will people be staying? You know, where will they be doing their studies? Now, this is challenging in the time of the pandemic, as we're doing largely remote lectures. But this is something that's definitely on our radar as the lockdown eases. We are also thinking of doing FAQ type of content. So what are the typical questions that our admissions get from prospective students? So maybe we could address some of those questions in our TikTok content. Anything fun, as long as it sits with your tone and with your brand. So we are increasingly seeing our students come on TikTok, and not many of them were there last summer when we launched. So it's actually nice to see that this new batch of students that came in last autumn, they are using TikTok. So we are able to now start sharing content from our students, as well as the colleges and some of the labs and departments that are coming onto TikTok. I already mentioned earlier that we've had to use sort of, you know, existing content and repurpose it a bit, which isn't ideal, but some of that has worked. We've even experimented with doing sort of slideshowy kind of things with a voiceover. So in the case of the Green Antarctica film, which I showed, that has worked quite well. So here's a few ideas for what you might be doing when you get started on TikTok. And then finally, what we've learned. So we don't have a channel lead and we're trying to share that responsibility. Now, most of my videographers like doing stuff in Premiere Pro, doing it professionally. They're used to doing things in you know, horizontal, doing it for YouTube, doing it for Facebook. So it is a bit of a learning curve to, you know, to keep in mind the safe areas for TikTok and always think about vertical first. And we are still finding our feet with the platform, the tone, what works, what looks right, whilst still being flexible so that our videographers don't feel like it's a massive burden for them. The mobile app is a bit fiddly. So if you are using that, it will require a bit of patience for you to do that. And yeah, I think I've mentioned the other things. Be creative when you're looking for content, try and repurpose it or spot talent from your existing bigger channels. And what we do on a weekly basis in our team meeting is we've got a list of potential TikTok leads that we discuss and come back to every week just to see, you know, is there a hook for this thing? Should we do that? What should we develop next? So that's it. If you've got any questions, I'd be happy to answer them now or later or outside of the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Annie. That's brilliant. Love the dancing academic. Crispin, any questions in there?
I'm a little conscious of time. I did have one thing that I was keen to ask was, and it occurred to me during Morgan's presentation, but also during yours, Anu, is what sort of response there's been from the leadership of the university to TikTok and to using TikTok? And if any of you are comfortable talking about what Florida University are doing with their president as well, that would be lovely if you're aware of that. But just some thoughts on leadership and TikTok from any of you, from whoever would like to take it.
I did look up Florida after you mentioned to me, Chris, but I loved it. I thought it was great. I would worry that it may not last forever. You know, there may be a stage where, you know, that engagement with that might run out. It's hard to tell if you're using like that a president or a senior leader for a lot of the content. I'd worry about that one focus a little bit, but I just said it, I've just mentioned in the comments there, I don't know about anywhere else, but I'm pretty sure most of the senior leaders in UL don't even know we have a TikTok. To be honest, we do of course mention it, and I think the fact we're very lucky again because we're the biggest account in the public sector in Ireland, and they're beginning to watch, for example, our public service TV station now developing accounts. Our senior leaders are quite happy that we're on there, even though they don't quite get it themselves. But the fact that it isn't a huge amount of a spend because we're using student creators, and the other point being that we know how narrowly focused that audience is really through that platform, and it being the exact age group that we would be looking for prospective students, that tends to focus the minds, so that helps. But I'm pretty sure they don't watch it.
Thank you. Susie?
Yeah, no, that's I think that's really interesting. I think we've all questioned that as I think we've been watching you. Really interesting. So thank you so much. I'm very aware of the time, as Crispin says. I think this is a topic we could talk about for a long time. I also think we should maybe revisit later on in the year and let's just see how we're all getting on. Actually, it would be really interesting. So I'd like to thank Matt and Sheena and Anu and Morgan for your time and for your fantastic presentations. You've given us all something to think about and learn from. And I'd like to thank Crispin for, I think it was your idea, this event. I think international, actually, you picked TikTok as a subject, so it's a winner. So thank you so much, everybody, for joining us. There will be a recording. It will be sent out to you on the email that you registered with. So thank you very much for that. Remember to get those CPD points and keep an eye on our next events from the international and the education skills sector groups. And we hope to see you again soon. Thank you. Thanks, guys. Have a good evening.